Hello and welcome. You're watching Medically Speaking and I am Meenakshi Upreti. Today we'll be speaking about World Stroke Day. What exactly is a stroke? What are the types of stroke? How do you or can you to begin with prevent a stroke to begin with? Why are we even talking about the World Stroke Day? This is a time I know all of you are talking about the 1 billion vaccination drive. We spoke about it a few days ago in detail, elaborately, but now it's time that we shift focus a little bit from COVID to other diseases equally important. Stroke. 3 in every Indian suffers from stroke, but that's something which is rarely spoken about. We don't know much about it. To talk about all of this and more, I have an expert panel with me. I'd like to welcome all of you. Thank you for joining us on NewsX. We have, of course, Dr. Padma. She is the head of neurosciences at AIIMS. We also have Dr. S.S. Kale. You can see him on your screens. He's the HOD of neurosurgery from AIIMS. Dr. Sanjay Vadva, HOD, PMR department of AIIMS. And Dr. Ayu, she's also an assistant professor of neurology at AIIMS. Now, this is a full AIIMS panel, one of the most elite institutes the country in the national capital. Dr. Padma, I'm going to start with you, ma'am. To begin with, in layman's terms, simply help our viewers understand why are we even talking about stroke? What exactly is a stroke? Why it's so important, so pertinent that in a country like ours, we increase awareness around stroke, ma'am?
Absolutely. Meenakshi, you said the right thing that why should we talk about stroke at all? Now, stroke, as we call a brain attack, is so staggering in terms of the burden of illness in the society, especially in the developing world where India is a prototype. Now, simply put it, you know, very simplistic terms, Meenakshi, as I speak now, we have a stroke happening every 20 seconds and a stroke death every 2 minutes. And in a year, in fact, last year, we had 18 lakh stroke patients in India. And of which 25%, that's almost 1/4, had happened to people who are younger than 40 years of age. So the brain attack or a stroke where in layman terms, it is acute paralysis or acute weakness of one side of the body, which is not sine qua non. There are several other ways a stroke can happen. That is when there is an acute shortage of blood supply to the brain. Very akin to heart attack, when there is a lack of blood supply to the heart muscle. So similarly, in the brain, as if there is a clot or there is a breakage of the blood vessel and there is a bleed and there's a lack of blood supply, for whatever be the reason, then there is an attack. And the reason why we say attack is it justifies the emergent action which is required. You know, it is all within minutes. And so that's why the theme for this World Stroke Day this time is time saves lives. Okay. And every minute counts. So that sort of, you know, it's telling you how pertinent, how mandatory, how paramount it is in terms of understanding what stroke is and how to respond to it as an emergency, because every minute counts.
All so right. The stroke every minute counts. I know, ma'am. You've put it very, very succinctly. Dr. Kale, if you could help elaborate on the last point Dr. Padma made. Extremely pertinent, extremely important, isn't it, Dr. Kale? Every minute counts. Why is awareness around strokes so important, and how can really these crucial golden minutes really help in saving someone's life, sir?
The problem is with the blood supply of the brain. If it stops suddenly, the neurons start dying. And unfortunately, neurons are one of those few cells in the body which do not regenerate. Like if you have some loss of skin, it regenerates, it heals itself. Other tissues heal themselves, they heal, wounds heal. There might be a scar, but it heals. But unfortunately, in the brain, if the neurons die, you've lost them for good, forever. They will never come back again. So that is why it is crucial to save as many neurons as possible. Yeah. And that you can do only if you act within minutes or at the most within the hour.
Right. It's really the golden hour which matters. But Dr. Vadva, help us understand. Now, a layman watching the show, what are the symptoms of stroke? How should someone perhaps who is surrounding a patient to someone who gets a stroke, how do they know that someone's getting a stroke? And what do they do to save that person?
Very good question. And one of the easiest ways to remember what are the warning signs or telltale signs of stroke are by the word fast. Because stroke being an emergency, it also indicates that one must act fast. So in this fast, F stands for face, A for arm, S for speech.
Okay.
And T, time is of great essence. So face gets affected in stroke. Hmm. The arm may become weak. The speech may get slurred or lost. And it all happens very suddenly, generally.
Yeah.
Some people have added two other alphabets to this also. B fast, B-E fast. Hmm. Here B stands for balance and E for eyesight. Okay. Because some of the stroke persons have imbalance or loss of balance. Hmm. And some people may have diminution of vision. So the symptoms and indications of stroke can be summed up very simply. B fast. This also encourages and emphasizes that if there is a suspicion of stroke, you must act very fast. Because if there is a delay, thousands and millions of brain cells may die permanently.
Yeah, and that's exactly the point which you and Dr. Kale both have made, really, the permanent dying of brain cells. But, you know, Dr. Padma, the suddenness of stroke also really takes the person who is getting a stroke and, of course, those who are surrounding him or her by surprise. What should, you know, someone who's around them do? Should they immediately rush them to a medical center? You know, slurring of speech, weakness or numbness in the arm. These are subtle, you know, signs. These aren't very prominent telltale signs, really. How can a person expedite the reaction time?
Absolutely. So, as you said, the spectrum with which a brain attack may present is protean. So as you said, it could be sudden loss of consciousness, which would be like, you know, everybody reacts to it. Oh, behosh ho gaya.
Yeah.
You know, or it could be very subtle, like there is a little deviation of the angle of the mouth or some weakness on one side. Or, you know, people would say, oh, it's possible my glucose is less in the body. Most diabetics feel so. And sometimes a stroke mimic presents that way. And, you know, you try to sleep it off or you'll say that it's only mild, maybe it will go away. And sometimes it does, which is called as a transient ischemic event, which is even dangerous because it is an harbinger of a major attack coming. Hmm. So therefore, how do you react to it? One, if you are aware that there is any sudden change in the function in the body, suddenness and a change in function. So that's the, you know, that's the hallmark, because the brain is a supercomputer which is commanding every single action of ours. So when there is a sudden change in that function, it could be stroke.
Hmm.
So better be there, better be aware than be sorry later.
Right.
Pick the patient up and go to the nearest stroke ready hospitals. The other issue here is that we need to have that map of stroke ready hospitals. You just go on to a place where there is no getting up to treat or managing a stroke, then it's going to again waste time. So that's important too. However, reach out to the nearest doctor, and all the doctors and all the medical personnel are also now aware that the moment they do know that there is a stroke, they need to immediately shift the patient to a stroke-ready hospital where a diagnosis can be made, because for a diagnosis, you need to have at least minimum a CT scan machine. And number two, if you can know that there is a clot in the artery, you need to unclog it, either by intravenous technique and sometimes mechanically take it out by a bigger center. So you have this primary stroke ready centers or a comprehensive and more advanced stroke center. So we do have those wheels in place in very, you know, big countries, even we have it.
Yeah.
But the thing is that you need to recognize and rush to the nearest stroke ready hospital. That's how you can manage a stroke.
Well, absolutely. And ma'am, you know, if you speak about really the types of stroke, what causes a stroke? Perhaps Dr. Kale, you could come in and shed some information on the same for our viewers. Types of stroke, what really causes a stroke? Hypertension, one reason we know. Tell us other reasons. What could cause a stroke, sir?
So let me first talk about the types of strokes. That's a very important thing which you have asked.
Hmm.
There are basically essentially two types of strokes. One is when the blood supply to the brain gets suddenly cut off, or if not to the brain entirely, then to one part of the brain. Say the part of the brain which controls your right side or a person's right side. And suddenly the blood supply is cut off. So the neurons which control the movement of the right half of the body will suddenly stop working. They will die. And then the right side of the person's body or the patient's body will stop working, say the right hand or the right leg or the right side of the face or all three even. So that is one kind of stroke. That is when the blood supply is suddenly cut off. The second type of stroke, which we say is a hemorrhagic stroke, is when there is a lot of bleeding in the brain, suddenly there is bleeding, one of the vessels bursts. It could be an artery, usually it's an artery, sometimes it could be a vein. It suddenly bursts and there is bleeding inside the brain, which causes a clot. You know, there's a big clot of blood which is sitting in some area of the brain. And this clot of brain causes pressure on the neurons. And again, it will cause damage. So it will cause damage wherever this clot is sitting. So basically, there are these two types of strokes. One, where the blood supply is completely cut off. And second, where there is excess blood in the brain, where it shouldn't be. The blood should always remain inside the blood vessels. But if it escapes that, then it causes a hemorrhagic stroke. So these are the two basic types of strokes.
Okay.
Now let's come to, you asked another very, very important question about risk factors. What are the risk factors? You know, which people get stroke? Am I likely to get stroke? Now, if I am a elderly person, then the chances of stroke are higher. If I am a smoker, the chances are higher. If I am a hypertensive, my chances are higher. If I am a diabetic, if I have diabetes, my chances are higher. If I have got hyperlipidemia, that is the lipid content in my blood is very high, I am likely to get stroke more than the other people. So these are the kind of risk factors which we talk about. Now, we generally divide these risk factors into two types. One is modifiable, where we can change by intervention.
Yes.
For example, if I'm obese, if I'm overweight, I can make I can do exercise, I can control my diet, I can lose weight, I can become fit. So being obesity being a modifiable risk factor.
Okay.
But there are certain risk factors which are non-modifiable. For example, age. If I'm already 75 years old, I can't decrease my age.
So, you spoke about two things, modifiable and non-modifiable risk factors as far as strokes are concerned. Let's focus on modifiables. Now, Dr. Vadwa, to come in here, you know, since we speak about, as you know, Dr. Kale also said, if someone has a history of hypertension, someone's a smoker, alcoholic, they're at a higher risk. Lifestyle modifications, can that reduce the chances of stroke or can they actually prevent stroke altogether, sir?
Our lifestyle has a major role to play in the causation of non-communicable diseases. And stroke is one of the leading examples of non-communicable diseases. And in the lifestyle, what we include are generally the level of physical activity and how regularly it is performed, the kind of food we eat, that is very important. So these are things that are very important components of lifestyle. The other factor is smoking. And all these are significant contributors either to the causation of stroke or to the causation of risk factors which lead to stroke. For example, smokers are likely to have more chances of having high blood pressure. High blood pressure itself will increase the chances of developing a stroke. People who are having very bad habits of eating, they are likely to put on weight. So by way of obesity, they are likely to have diabetes. Diabetes itself is a major risk factor for stroke. So these are all interlinked. Your unhealthy lifestyle will make you more prone to develop so many disorders, such as obesity, diabetes, hypertension, coronary artery disease, and most importantly, stroke. That is the condition that we are discussing now. So if you intervene in modifying the lifestyle, then you can reduce to a significant extent the risk of stroke and some other diseases that I have mentioned just now.
But so, you know, when you speak about non-modifiable factors, other risk factors, Dr. Padma, say race, age, gender, family history, they're outside a person's control. Can those people also, who perhaps are at a disadvantage because of these uncontrollable factors, can they also make some modifications, if not to totally prevent, at least reduce the risk of a stroke, Dr. Padma?
Yes, definitely yes. Because, for example, as Professor Vadwa so rightly said, that a lot of these, what we call as a conventional vascular risk factors, which is hypertension, in fact, I would say hypertension number one, number two, number three is hypertension. Also, of course, diabetes and your propensity to put on weight. It's obesity is not always, you know, sine qua non to that you're eating a lot. And sometimes you have this genetic predisposition, they just become a pear-shaped body. Now, all those people, and especially when there is a family history of either heart attacks or a brain attack, or even a kidney disease, you get your blood pressure checked, get your blood sugar checked when you cross 30. And if they are high, go to a doctor, get the prescription, modify your lifestyle. And one of the commonest things Meenakshi people do is blood pressure, you take the drug, BP is okay, you forget the drug. You say BP is normal, then why do I take it? And blood pressure is a silent killer. Therefore, sticking to a regime, compliance and consistently being that, you can reduce the risk even if you're genetically predisposed. You don't have to have this. You can prevent the heart attack and the brain attack. So being again aware of this and not being complacent of it. Methods, I'm just 40 years old. Why would it happen to me? That's one of the biggest mistakes we do. Right. And coming back to lifestyle, Meenakshi, I'm sure, you know, you're so young and even you should listen to this, is that we, you know, the one of the commonest things that we sort of sacrifice is sleep. And, you know, we tend to be in a rat race, and that's one of the reasons why probably the young people are getting affected is, one, of course, we have young BP patients, young diabetics, young everything, besides smoking, besides lifestyle, is also the stress. And also we sacrifice a lot of those things which we take for granted. Multitasking, too much of, you know, to do things which we go on to a goal and the goalposts keep changing, stress levels keep rising, and no sleep. I mean, in the sense that, you know, your night and day definitely have no other meaning. So all these things add up. And I must say that probably they are, along with air pollution and so many other issues and getting exposed to that, I think a lot of contributions why we are heading towards a stroke epidemic now. So yes, all of them can be managed if you are aware and take those actions, preventive and preempt any of those damage to happen.
Right. You know, now we've spoken about how to prevent the stroke, how we can make these lifestyle modifications, sir, but what about life with stroke, Dr. Kali? You know, we know 80 million people have unfortunately experienced a stroke, but many of them, you know, tend to lead a normal life also after that. Elaborate on a little bit, really, sir, on the rehabilitation part, which Dr. Padma had just touched upon, sir.
Yeah, so that's very important question you asked, because many times, you know, people are unprepared for this. You can't ever be prepared for a calamity like this. You can maybe modify some risk factors and, you know, try to prevent it as much as possible. But some unfortunate people do suffer it. And so many millions of them do suffer. In spite of being aware, sometimes you land up in such a problem. But that doesn't mean that you lose hope and you stop living. You don't. You carry on. You fight on. And there are ways and means. And there are other things available which can help mitigate a loss of the loss which you have suffered because of stroke. First thing, of course, is to follow the doctor's advice and make all the changes in your diet or regime or etc. etc. So the risk factors again come into play. Those have to be controlled, definitely. Second, once you do have a loss, we have experts like Professor Vadva and the whole department and the whole physical medicine and rehabilitation team, which will help you live life to as normal as possible. You know, there are many, many things available now, including, I mean, we have seen people with that exoskeleton start walking, completely paralyzed patients wear the exoskeleton and they walk about. So technology has moved tremendously. It has moved forward tremendously. We can help many patients. People are now trying to devise implants which can make a person see again, even after becoming blind. So you see, I think Professor Vadva can answer these questions.
Yeah, let me take, I was just going to say that. So let me take this to Professor Vadva. So since we are speaking of the 3 hours of stroke, you spoke about how to spot a stroke fast. And then also the 3 hours of stroke, recognition, rehabilitation and recovery. Elaborate a little bit on the rehabilitation and recovery part, sir, please.
I'm glad Professor Kale has so beautifully emphasized the role of physical medicine and rehabilitation. It is a teamwork. It is a comprehensive care plan which has a continuum. It is not that you do it for 10 days and then stop. So it is a continuum of care, and some of the specific ingredients of this rehabilitation plan have to be modified along the course of the journey. Rehabilitation is a journey. It normally begins in an institutional setting where the person is admitted, generally under the care of neurologists in the acute stage. And once the neurologists have stabilized the person, life is saved. It is important to remember that although unfortunately some of the people who suffer stroke, they die. but a large majority of people survive. And many of these survive with a residual disability. So we have to initiate early steps so that the extent of disability is reduced as much as possible. And the rehabilitation can begin in the early stage itself. Once the expert neurologist have certified that the person is now clinically stable. So normal guidelines suggest that the rehabilitation can begin as early as 24 to 48 hours after the onset of acute stroke. And then there are certain guidelines which are evidence-based by eminent organizations like American Stroke Association, American Heart Association. And I'm very glad to inform that Indian guidelines are also there. These are also evidence-based, which are endorsed by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And Professor M.B. Padma Srivastava was an important contributor to framing of those guidelines. And these are very comprehensive guidelines, which have elaborated according to the different stages as the person progresses, what are the components of stroke rehabilitation. And in the simplest possible way, if I may say, these are easy to remember by the alphabet E. So evaluation of the stroke affected person, that is very critical, but that will help you decide the subsequent components of the treatment and rehabilitation. The second E is education, how to live a life despite stroke. How do you modify your diet? How do you initiate and modify your physical activities? The third important E is exercises, because exercises are central component of an activity-based rehabilitation plan. The other important E is equipments. Many stroke survivors with disabilities, they will require various equipments, which we call aids and appliances or assistive technology products. Yeah. These will facilitate the mobility or walking about or hand function. Many other things, even speech improvement assistive devices are also there. And the final E is modification of the immediate environment so that there are no barriers to free movement. The access to different parts of the house and community is barrier free. So these are some of the components of a comprehensive rehabilitation plan.
Right. And I wish we could speak more elaborately on the intervention, which you were just speaking about, sir. But unfortunately, we're running a little out of time. So I'll just take a final closing comment from all three of you. Dr. Padma, ma'am, as we sign off, really, what would be your advice to those who have watched the show, who perhaps, feel that they could have a predisposition to smoke, as you rightly mentioned? Unfortunately, we are seeing a large number of population affected by strokes, which is a younger population, something perhaps which was not very common at least a decade ago. I mean, it's increased by 100%, if I'm correct.
Correct. So what are the take-home messages? Number one, prevent stroke. That's most important. You just have one supercomputer, which is equal to your life. Prevent anything from happening to it. Road traffic accidents, also brain attacks. Number two, if there is a stroke happening, be aware how to recognize it. Reach out as an emergency. It is an emergency, so you should not waste any time. As again, we say, time saves lives. Every minute counts. That's the theme of the World Stroke Day. Number three, if there has been an unfortunate incident, don't lose hope. The earlier you rehabilitate, the better the recovery is. Never lose hope. Every stroke recovers. Small extent, large extent, it's in your hands.
Absolutely.
Take that. Yeah.
Well, absolutely. I think you've really summed it up succinctly, ma'am. I'd like to thank all the experts really for joining us, sharing your views on the World Stroke Day. I hope this episode has been as informative and riveting for our viewers as it has been for me. Younger or older, whatever be your gender, stroke doesn't discriminate. Early detection, of course, early diagnosis is the key. Recognize the sign, rush to a nearest hospital if such an unfortunate situation presents itself. That really could go miles in saving lives, in perhaps even preventing stroke. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you so much.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.